Well, once again, good evening. My name is Krishna Lalbiharie, and on behalf of Canadian Dimensions Coordinating Committee and Magazine Collective, I'd like to welcome you all to this evening, to this, our magazine's Winnipeg launch of our new book, Canada Since 1960, A People's History, published by Lorimer and Company. Once again, I'd like to begin, as always, by acknowledging and honoring that we are gathered here on Treaty 1 territory, the traditional and sacred land of the Métis people. Our format today is going to be quite short, actually. We're going to have presentations, brief presentations from our five panelists, followed by questions and answers from you all as you see fit. We have books at the back for sale. What you do is you pick them up and then you pay for them at the counter. We also have magazines, our last two issues, plus subscription forms and a form if you'd wish to sign up to our new e-newsletter. So to begin, our panel is comprised of a prestigious group of individuals connected with Canadian Dimension, past and present, all of whom have worked within their respective fields as advocates for progressive change, social justice, and human rights. They, each of them, require a little introduction, but allow me to say this of each of them. James Lorimer, originally from Winnipeg, is the publisher of Lorimer and Company, founded in the 1970s. Lorimer's works reflect a progressive voice for groundbreaking reporting on a variety of social justice and human rights themed works. Says James Lorimer himself, quote, "I started publishing books because there were things going on unsaid that needed to be discussed in public. Books are a powerful vehicle for putting ideas and information out there and for sparking debate." I'd also like to introduce Jim Silver, who is professor and chair of urban and inner city studies at the University of Winnipeg. Activist and author, Jim has published extensively on inner city and poverty related issues and was a considerably active and integral member of Canadian Dimensions Collective for a good 10 years or more. Arthur Schafer is a professor of philosophy and director of the Center for Professional and Applied Ethics at the University of Manitoba. His areas of specialization include bioethics, philosophy of law, and social and political philosophy. He additionally contributed a critical article on health in Canada in our new book. Nahani Fontaine is an Indigenous women's rights activist, advocate, author, and academic known mostly for her work in connection with missing and murdered Indigenous women and girls in Canada, alongside her work with their family members. While her resume boasts in the areas of justice and women's and children's rights advocacy, I wish to highlight proudly that Nahani was elected this past April 19. Did my mic go off? Sorry. I wish to highlight that Nahani was elected this past April 19th as the first urban Indigenous woman MLA in Manitoba to sit in the House of the Manitoba Legislature. She represents the St. John's constituency for today's NDP. And finally, Cy Gonick. Cy Gonick is the founder and publisher of Canadian Dimension magazine from its first days in 1963 until now. He is many things to many people: publisher, former politician, professor, author, activist, organizer. Indeed, he is known to us under the rubric of various titles. To me, he and always shall be the Papa Smurf of our magazine's collective and coordinating committee. He even has the beard now. I am happy to share with you also that Cy this past April turned 80. And without further ado, let's welcome the man himself to the stage. Please join me in welcoming Cy Gonick.
Thank you so much. I'm sorry I'm late. I thought I was taking a brief nap, and it wasn't so brief. I'm looking around now for the first time to see who's here. I'm delighted that you're able to come. And what I want to do is, I wrote an introduction to this book, and I wrote a chapter in the book. My introduction was quite brief. My chapter is a detailed account, from my point of view, of the history of Canadian Dimension. And so it contains all kinds of stories, inside dope, the fights we had, the words we used in combat. I'm sure I hope you'll want to read that. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to read from my introduction, which basically gives you a good feel, I think, for what's in this book. So here goes. This book is unique because it's it has 25 different authors, each one of which wrote a chapter on one of the themes that Dimension has emphasized, focused on over the years. And of course, Dimension itself has involved hundreds of authors. Undoubtedly, the entire Canadian left has written for this magazine at one time or another. So it's unique in all those respects. And of course, it's 50 odd years in the making. So that's also a unique feature of the book. I opened up on the page of the foreword, which is written by my friend Mel Watkins. It's not what I wanted. So I start off by saying, when I began producing Dimension back in 1963, it never occurred to me that it would still be around more than 50 years later. In point of fact, it should never have lasted beyond that first issue. I had no money, I had no funding, I had no business experience or knowledge of how to produce a magazine. And I knew very few writers that I could call on, because I had just come from back to Winnipeg from the States. Somehow, though, we managed to beat the odds and go on to become the longest-lived magazine of the independent left in Canada. And indeed, among the longest-lasting magazines ever published in this country. Without corporate advertising or political sponsorship, with few government grants, and despite a dismal financial history, Canadian Dimension survived to celebrate its 50th anniversary. And as of this writing, we are planning our 316th issue. Of course, since I wrote that, there have been more issues than that, and we have a sample of them here. The opening chapter of this book, as I've mentioned, is my version of the history of Dimension from 1963 to 2013. I don't even try to take the measure of the magazine's contribution and impact over the years, only what we're trying to do and why. Each chapter revolves around a particular theme that the Dimension focused on throughout its history. And the only instruction I gave to the contributing authors is that I wanted their unvarnished evaluation of how well and specifically how insightfully the magazine dealt with the theme assigned to them. And as you'll see if you read the book, few held back. Overall, CD published over 300 issues in this period, about 50,000 pages, an average of 75 to 100 authors contributed articles to the magazine each year. More important than the sheer numbers is that they comprise a large portion of the intellectual left active in English Canada in the past 50 years. So CD can be seen as a piece of Canadian social and intellectual history from a left perspective. Some water?
Yes. Sorry.
convention has always been committed to socialist values of equality and participatory democracy, extending democracy throughout all dimensions of life, but has never been officially or informally associated with any political party. To be sure, some of its editors have been members of one party or another over the years, but Dimension per se has always been fiercely independent, beholden to no institution, and financed almost entirely by its subscribers. The magazine's founders and earliest contributors were young men, mainly in their 20s, a few in their early 30s. I have managed to stay actively involved, engaged in the magazine throughout its 50-plus years. But each decade or so, a small cohort of Dimension editors emerged that helped shape the concerns and character of the magazine. In the early years, the cohort included David Sheps, Gad Horowitz, John Warnock, Bruce Kidd, Alvin Finkel. In the middle years, it broadened to include the likes of Jim Silver, Paul Graham, Fred Gubinson, and Henry Heller. More recently, Andrea Levy has joined me in steering CD. And as declining health conditions inevitably sap some of my energy, I hope she will be accompanied by other stalwarts and newcomers in determining the current and future direction of the magazine. And in fact, that has happened already. We have a coordinating committee of five or six people across the country. We meet every week on Skype, and we run the magazine. So that's a huge relief for me. Certain themes have recurred with striking regularity and Dimension. What role Canada plays in the world, and particularly in the American Empire, what role a more independent Canada could play, how imperialism works and how to build a movement to defeat it, how to give full and sustained recognition of the two nations, Canada and Quebec, either in one state or two, how the capital system produces social injustice, income insecurity, and growing inequality, how liberal and social democratic reforms can never yield workable remedies, what alternatives to capitalism might look like, what strategies are necessary to build movements to effectively challenge capital. And of course, much has changed since Dimension was founded. The movement for Quebec self-determination, and years later, the movement for First Nations sovereignty, the rise of feminism and gay liberation, the environmental crisis, and the urgent need to stop climate change, the internet, social media, the surveillance state, none of this had existed in 63, or we could even imagine at that time. On the world scene, the disintegration of the Soviet Union, the consolidation of American global dominance, then the unexpected rise of 21st century socialist governments in Latin America, the upheaval in the Arab countries, the breakdown of new wars in Iraq, Libya, and Afghanistan. Many of these were anticipated, and all of them were reflected and dissected in CD's pages, and more recently on our website. How is it that a magazine with such flimsy finances has managed to survive over 50 years, when in the same period, dozens of publications are founded, flourished briefly, floundered, and then expired. Some with massive advertising and circulation numbers 5 and 10 times larger than CDs. Perhaps part of the explanation is that I have never been concerned with commercial success. Profit was never a consideration. Our business model consisted largely of soliciting left academics and activists who write for us as an act of solidarity and as an expression of their practical political engagement. We offered meager pay to part-time staff, to those contributors who had no other source of income, and to designers. Whatever was left, we plowed back into the magazine for extra pages or color. Further, no magazine has enjoyed a more stable and more loyal readership. Through most years, up to a third of our readers have contributed a sum of money beyond the subscription price. In our 50th anniversary issue, March-April 2013, some of our veteran writers volunteered their thoughts on how Dimensions managed to survive for over five decades. Quote, no one has its hooks in CD. It stuck to its independence from vested interests on the left, including the NDP and labor bureaucracy. It has not been afraid to criticize, even sharply at times. End of quote from Stan Gray. To this observation, I would add that it's true. Dimension has managed to piss off at least once just about every participant in civil society. But being independent has also allowed us to take our shots and give activists the space to take theirs. Of course, there have been times that we've paid a steep price for this independence. We've been boycotted, lost our charity number, sued, and threatened with losses. Another quote, today's CD is far more willing to put front and center the perspective of Aboriginal peoples, women, environmentalists, gays, and others who barely figured in the journal's worldview in the early days, while maintaining, indeed, even being more forceful in its critique of the market economy, which threatens the existence of humanity and all other species. That's from Alvin Finkel. Some of you recognize him. He's from Winnipeg also, now a professor at Athabasca University. And another comment. Historically, the pivotal role played by many CD contributors in the feminist struggles taking place in the economic, political, and cultural spheres renders their contribution of particular significance, and the magazine truly provides a living archive of a vibrant and a dynamic era, as Stephanie Ross. One more. Canadian Dimension has not managed to change the world decisively, a rather tall order for one small publication in one particular corner of the globe. But it has provided a forum, especially in Canada, in which those who are committed to this project can discuss what needs doing and how to do it. This necessarily involves debate, exchange, and at times heated disagreement. It entails sharing information and keeping old insights alive, as well as being willing to entertain and learn more of the new ones. For 50 years, Dimension has been doing all this and more. Few magazines of the left have had this kind of continuity. That's from Brian Palmer. On a personal note, Canadian Dimension has been my daily preoccupation for over 53 years. Apart from my children, it has been the one constant in my life. I am very grateful to all the comrades who have worked alongside me over the years to produce Dimension. And I want to extend my thanks to all those who contributed chapters to this book. In an exclusive interview in Montreal on the occasion of his benefit lecture to mark CD's 50th anniversary, Noam Chomsky was asked what kind of role he thought a small left-wing magazine like Dimension could play. He replied that it was pretty impressive how CD had been helping to keep activism alive for more than 50 years, encouraging interaction and stimulating organizational efforts, especially in the absence of the kind of lively working class culture and vibrant left press that had thrived prior to the 1950s. Quoting Chomsky, someone has to keep the spark alive. And that is a badge of pride. That is a badge I wear with pride. That's my introduction. I'm anxious to hear your comments, your questions, but I yield the stage to other participants.
Thank you, Cy. That was a great, great introduction and a summary of our publishing history over the last 53 years. What I'm going to do now is for our four panelists who graciously agreed to participate in today's panel, or launch, I should say, I'm going to ask each of them to answer a question which is individual and specific to them. I'd like to begin with Jim Lorimer, again, the publisher of this wonderful book. And my question simply to Jim is, why did you elect to publish this book? So please join me in welcoming Jim Lorimer.
Thanks very much, and good evening, everybody. It's great to see all of you here for this really special event. The last time I was in Winnipeg was actually for the 50th anniversary ballroom celebration at the Fort Garry. And I found to my astonishment that I was sitting at the corporate table that had been purchased by the Winnipeg Free Press. And I thought it was a real testimonial to the CD and to Cy, you know, that even the Winnipeg Free Press felt that after 50 years there was a form of recognition that was deserved for the effort of Cy and all of those of you who've been involved in CD. So I am going to answer the question, but I first of all want to say that Cy and I have more in common than I realized. When Cy was explaining how it was that he stumbled into becoming the publisher, I could really identify with had no money, had no business experience, didn't know anything about what I was doing. The one difference between us actually was that you said you knew no writers. And in 1970, when I started the publishing company, I had the benefit of knowing one writer, Heather Robertson. And Heather at that time had written a manuscript of thousands of pages in length, based on her experience at visiting First Nations communities all around Western Canada. And she had had it at McClellan Stewart for consideration for 18 months. It was in boxes. And in those days, photocopying was done on a kind of funny paper that was really, really heavy. So actually this was a manuscript when you tried to lift the box that contained the manuscript, it would take two people to do. There were so many pages and it was so heavy. But it was a brilliant book. It stands, actually. It stands up extremely well in all of Heather's nonfiction, right up to the time of the series of novels that she wrote based on William Lyon Mackenzie King, all of which I published. That got me into publishing, and actually it brought Cy and me together because I was able to publish Cy's book, Inflation or Depression, one of the early really important books in the political economy spirit in Canada. So when Cy contacted me after my attendance at the celebration, when Cy contacted me and told me that there was a book that he and the contributors had prepared, which was based on 50 years of Canadian dimension, I knew immediately that I would publish it, but of course it's not good to tell an author that. So I got him to send me the manuscript. That was the first step. And actually, the only thing that I added to this book was that when I read it, I felt that it could be presented as in the way that it now is presented. It actually is a history of Canada since 1960. It's a history of Canada as seen by a group of writers with a very clear perspective and a very perspective that diverges hugely from most of what's been written about Canadian history since 1960. And I felt that what I could contribute by putting that title on the book, which of course, as you can imagine, one publisher struggling with another publisher to get his way about what a book title would be took some backing and forthing. But to put that title on the book, what I hope will happen is that I hope that it will say, especially to young readers who only know about Canadian history since 1960 by reading about it, unlike those of us who've lived through it, I hope that what it'll do is to demonstrate the existence of a whole other train of thought and analysis than what they typically are exposed to, and that it'll open up a new audience for Canadian Dimension as an ongoing publication. So I really do hope it's a book that I think that all of us, I certainly found it really interesting, even though I lived through the period, there was a lot there that, you know, that passed me by at the time, and I think that many of you will find the same thing. But most importantly, it's a book that for young readers, exposed to the information and the analysis that it offers, I hope that it'll encourage them to look to Canadian Dimension on an ongoing basis, as well as to have a much more sophisticated perspective on what's really been happening in Canada in the last 50 years and what the potential is for Canada if, you know, if it's ever possible to get a more democratic and more socially just society than we've been able to do in the last 50 years. So anyway, I'm very glad to be here, and I'm really grateful for Cy and for the contributors to produce. There are a lot of words there, but that in the end, I think that I hope that you'll agree with me that they're all, it's a really, every word is very worthwhile in terms of what the book offers. Thank you very much.
Whoa. Thank you, Jim. Now on to another Jim, that being Jim Silver. The question that I have for Jim, once again, please try and keep this within 5 minutes if at all possible. How would you evaluate or describe CD's political impact or role over the past 50 plus years? The clock has started.
Was I over?
What's that?
Was I over?
Good evening, everyone. So I didn't know about this question until I arrived here, although I did have some notes that touch partly on this. So I think I would divide the 50 years into two parts, the early part, the more recent part. And the early part is in some respects the most important. I think Canadian Dimension played a very important role in Canada in the 1960s. Cy had been at Berkeley in the very early 1960s, where he was exposed to and was part of the free speech movement led by Mario Savio. That had a huge impact on him. He came back up to Canada and brought those ideas here to this country with him and set out to publish Canadian Dimension in order to generate a similar kind of experience here in Canada. And Canadian Dimension became the venue for many of the great young left-wing scholar activists of the time. At that time, there were very few, if any, academic journals that were prepared to publish left-wing authors. So Canadian Dimension became the venue for the kinds of people who were emerging at the time who had an interest in Canadian political economy, in a left nationalist kind of position. It had a big impact, I think, fed into this movement that was growing. Cy and Canadian Dimension played a significant role, for example, in the Waffle movement toward the end of the 1960s. Cy was active with the Waffle. Canadian Dimension became, in a sense, the voice of the Waffle. So all through those 1960s, I think Canadian Dimension was playing a very, very important role as the voice of a new and vibrant intellectual left. Subsequent to that period, move into the second period. To put it a little bit provocatively, I think in the second period a revolution happened, though it was not the revolution that Cy had been calling for. It's the revolution that is still going on today, the revolution that capital has brought to us, that the political right has brought to us, the astonishingly rapid and ongoing technological change, the globalization of the economy, the driving down of the role of the state, the driving down of wages, the move to precarious labor. All these kinds of really revolutionary things have gone on over the last 30 or 40 years. They continue to this day. So that the role that Canadian Dimension played during that period was quite a different one, and I think an important one, which is to keep alive left-wing ideas at a time when they were at risk of being completely buried. So I think Canadian Dimension struggled, certainly in the 80s when I was there. I would say we struggled a little bit trying to figure out what our place was. But taking an active role around free trade, for example, over the years, fighting against neoliberalism, with neoliberalism, which incorporates all the kinds of things that I've described as part of this revolutionary process. Interestingly, the International Monetary Fund has recently come out in agreement with Cy and Canadian Dimension in saying, well, holy smokes, then neoliberalism doesn't work after all. So way to go on that, Cy. I think we're about to head into a third era, and it will be important for Canadian Dimension to play a role in this, and I'm not sure what that role might be, but I think the new era is the era of Bernie Sanders, it's the era of Jeremy Corbyn, it's the era of the obvious failure of the neoliberal project. People around the world, and young people in particular, are looking for an alternative. They're looking for a different way forward, and fearless publications like Canadian Dimension are going to have an important role to play in this, yet to be determined. So, Cy, we look forward to the next 50 years, 50 years from now, another book such as this, and I look forward to reading
it. I'll be here.
So congratulations, Cy.
Okay, thank you, Jim. Next, I'd like to call upon Arthur Schafer. Arthur, my question for you is, you contributed a significant article on health in Canada since 1960. Could you give us a précis of your findings?
I will give a précis, but I have to start by picking up a theme that that Jim mentioned, the corporate sponsorship by the Winnipeg Free Press, because, and I probably this isn't the right occasion to do a big expose of Canadian Dimension, but Cy's pleas of financial poverty and hard times are really a front. Canadian Dimension has been nothing short of a money machine all these years. And the board of directors has cleverly invested the profits from your subscription in mining stocks and banks. And you will find, if you go to the new Winnipeg Airport, that beside the corporate jets of Investor Syndicate and the Royal Bank is the CD corporate jet, on which Jim, I'm sure, flew to Winnipeg for his trip here. So just don't believe the pleas about poverty. It's all a story. The insiders have been living very high off the hog. Okay, I think I probably used up my 5 minutes, so I have at least, perhaps I have 3 minutes to talk about healthcare. When Cy invited me to write the healthcare chapter, which involved going back for half a century and reading articles on Medicare, on health, on AIDS, on social dimensions of health. When Cy first invited me, I said no, as I quite often have over the years when Cy's invited me to do something, just because I wasn't competent. I'm not an historian. This wasn't something for which any of my skills fitted me, but somehow, whenever I say no, I almost always Cy figures out a way to twist me to his will, and so here I am having written the chapter. It was really interesting to read 50 years of articles, and now I'm going to perhaps just flag two or three of the impressions I got from these, and perhaps if some of you buy the book and read my contribution in it, you'll see for yourselves how amazing the magazine has been on the issue of health. I don't know if the magazine stands up as well in other domains, but Canadian Dimension was born roughly at the same time as Medicare, right after the Second World War, Tommy Douglas government in Saskatchewan brought in hospital care in Canada. This was the time when the British Labour government of Clement Attlee brought in Medicare in Britain. We didn't get it in Canada until the early to mid 60s, but Saskatchewan got it first. hospital care, 1946, and then Medicare in one province, as we might describe it, in Saskatchewan in the early 60s. Tommy Douglas brought in the bill, stepped aside to run federally. Woodrow Lloyd introduced it to Saskatchewan. And Diefenbaker was the Prime Minister of Canada at this time. And what a dramatic, I mean, Diefenbaker's a conservative, Stephen Harper's a conservative, but what a dramatic world of difference. Diefenbaker decided that maybe what was good for Saskatchewan would be good for Canada. And he invited his friend Emmett Hall to establish a royal commission. Canadian Dimension gave Emmett Hall 6 pages of the magazine to talk about his findings in this report, because essentially what Emmett Hall said is that Canada should have a universal single-payer healthcare system modeled on the Saskatchewan model. Well, Diefenbaker didn't win the next election, so Tommy Douglas was a father of Medicare, Emmett Hall, John Diefenbaker, and then under the Pearson government it was introduced. The following 50 years of articles in Dimension focused on all the ways in which Medicare became really, if you had to say what's the religion of Canada, it's Medicare. And no party, even the Conservatives under Stephen Harper, no party has ever felt able to propose the abolition of Medicare. Instead, what's been happening almost since the beginning, we made a mistake. We knew we were making a mistake. The British Labour Party knew it was making a mistake. Nye Bevan said, in order to get the doctors on side, we'll stuff their mouths with gold. And that's what we did. We allowed Medicare to develop based on entrepreneurial medicine, doctors. The payment for services was universal. Everyone was entitled according to need. But the payment was to physicians who were small business people in private practice, and it was fee for service. And that initial decision may be politically necessary, I'm not in a good position to say, but it so distorted the way medicine was practiced that we developed a whole series of crises. And now in many provinces and also federally, there's talk about whether Medicare is sustainable, whether it's become so expensive that the fundamental bargain, I call it the middle class bargain, on which Medicare was established, is under threat. And the middle class bargain was the promise that Medicare would provide all medically necessary services, physician services and hospital services, to everyone in Canada. Didn't matter how fat or thin your wallet was, the government would pay. And the promise was that the service would be of good quality and that it would be provided in a timely way. And as medicine became more technocratic, and as physicians became more and more affluent and expected higher and higher incomes, which they were able to generate because of fee-for-service, some of them seeing 50 patients a day, even 70 patients a day, whipping patients through in an industrial kind of medicine where you get 3 minutes as a sign on the office wall that says one complaint only per visit. Isn't that obscene? But how can you practice medicine? I mean, maybe if you have 2 or 3 complaints, they're connected and the doctor might actually learn what's wrong with you. At all events, this kind of medicine, plus the proliferation of a lot of high technology, a lot of tests, did lead to an escalation of costs. Well, what Dimension has done, and here I'll just try in 90 seconds to encapsulate a whole bunch of profoundly important and different themes that were discussed in the magazine over the last half century and that I try to describe and critique in my chapter. It turns out that the costs of healthcare, at least the costs of Medicare, the publicly funded part of Medicare, doctors and hospitals, has been stable for decades. And the rapid escalation has been in those parts of the healthcare system that have been privatized, namely drugs, home care, physiotherapy,
actually, if you look at all the things that were left out of Medicare, dental care is not part of universal health insurance. This is surely the huge omissions. Each province has a different drug scheme, but drugs are very poorly covered in many parts of the country. So drugs, medical devices, home care, physiotherapy, much mental health care has to be sought outside the system. The parts that have dramatically increased in cost have been the ones that are privatized, and in particular drugs. Drugs now swallow up mostly or many of them useless, many of them harmful. Prescription drugs taken as directed now represent the third largest cause of death in Canada. Never mind disability and other problems. So what you find in over the last 50 years, a series of articles defending Medicare. No one dared, not the Liberal, but the Liberals under Chrétien with Paul Martin's austerity budgets, so dramatically reduced the funding to the provinces that there was no longer a federal stick to force them to maintain standards, and gradually services began to be deselected. The medically necessary list, the list of medically necessary services got shorter and shorter. Private clinics began to be established. Eye care had to be purchased privately. If you didn't want a long waiting list for your cataract operation or your hip operation, you had to go to a private clinic. So that's where we are today, faced with a kind of salami, slice by slice, nobody head-on confronting Medicare, but diminishing it, attenuating it, whittling it away, so that enough people will become dissatisfied that they'll buy private insurance. Well, if I'm privately insured, my stake in the public system goes down, the public system becomes a slum. To some extent, this is already happening in Britain. It, of course, has happened in the States. It hasn't happened here yet, but it's a real threat. And for 50 years, writers in Dimension have been exposing this and critiquing it. Let me just conclude by saying, health is about a lot more than healthcare. And Dimension has had a series of articles talking about the social determinants of health, the way in which poverty and social class and gender and ethnicity profoundly influence poverty, but also inequality. And there have been articles exposing the ways in which the most unequal of the wealthy societies have far worse health outcomes than the more equal. So Japan and Sweden, as examples of two very wealthy Western countries, have vastly better mortality, morbidity, child health rates than America and Britain. And Canada's inequality is about in between, and our health outcomes are in between. So Dimension has published a whole bunch of articles, interesting ones, often anticipating trends that you find became prominent in academic discussions later on. Articles on First Nations and health, and the way in which lack of clean water and lack of employment and all the things that that constitute the social determinants of health have resulted in a disastrous health situation for many First Nations people. And you find that as you go from the top of the socioeconomic scale to the bottom, every disease gets worse, every health condition gets worse, life expectancy gets worse, child mortality gets worse. And it doesn't matter whether you're talking about mental illness or strokes or heart attack or cancer or arthritis or diabetes, no matter what the disease or condition, if you're poor in an unequal society, your fate is likely to be much worse. So Dimension has consistently connected health issues with social justice issues in a way that I found really illuminating, and I shouldn't have been surprised, but I think it was a remarkable set of essays, some of them contributed by Jim Silver, some by Bob Chernomas and other Winnipeg authors. I think it's been a really solid contribution to the discussion, not just of health care, but of health, of environmental health and the way it relates to individual health. So Dimension has earned its the fabulous wealth that they've managed to stash away. Thank you very much.
I loved how you brought it back to that your stand-up bit at the beginning. Okay, and so finally, my last question is for Nahani Fontaine. So the last two issues of CD, and you can find these at the back, were focus editions on racism and on childhood, respectively, which highlighted several areas in respect of Indigenous rights, violence against Indigenous women, children, and the like. Nahani, could you speak to this epidemic in Canada, violence against Indigenous women and girls? Please join me in welcoming Nahani.
So first off, I just want to say congratulations to Cy and to everybody that's been involved in CD. I think, I don't know when it was, I was involved for like 2 minutes, I think. I went to maybe two meetings. I was on the thing, but also, I don't know if you remember me.
Oh, I remember you.
Hi.
Well.
I just saw you. I was like, hey, this is actually one of my first professors when I was doing my first degree. I did geography with you. We looked at OPIC and all of that. You're one of my favorite profs ever. And you wrote, I don't know if you remember this, you wrote my reference letter to get into the master's program. I did complete it, just so you know. Thank you. Thanks. So hello. Anine, everyone. So in the 4 minutes that I have, I'm just going to say that quite obviously in Canada we have an epidemic of really just savage violence that's perpetrated against Indigenous women and children and in particular girls, which is fundamentally predicated upon and is born out of our colonial history. So you know, when Krishna's question is, can you tell us a little bit about that? That in a nutshell is what it is, right? And so typically, you know, I can teach this in 3 months, or I can give workshops in several hours, in 4 minutes, now three. You know, I think it's really important to recognize that the issue of missing and murdered Indigenous women and girls, like I said, is fundamentally predicated upon that colonial history, which a lot of Canadian Dimension speaks about when we write articles on racism and social inequality. That is all part and parcel the same consequences to this colonial history that we all share in Canada. You know, where we are today is fundamentally different than where we were, you know, 30 years ago or 20 years ago or even 10 years ago. For myself personally, I've been working on the issue for probably the last 18 years, and I've seen this chronological sequence of events that have brought us to where, you know, now I'm asked to speak on missing and murdered all around. That movement was fundamentally born on really fearless, amazingly resilient, courageous, loving families who demanded justice, who demanded that as a society that we look at this issue and that we unpacked those race and gendered and class narratives in which the issue was for so many years just dismissed and pushed aside, or the women and the girls themselves were blamed, right? And so we have families, you know, I often talk about that this issue didn't just come to the forefront in the last, you know, 4 or 5 years, that in fact families from across the country, and in particular BC with the Highway of Tears, have been working on this issue for the last 30 years. In Winnipeg, in Manitoba, you may or may not know that in fact Winnipeg is considered ground zero for missing and murdered Indigenous women and girls, and there are phenomenal families that have been working on this issue demanding justice. And what happened in that evolution or that process to bring us to where we are today is that it has been Indigenous women who have stood with families in a myriad of different ways, through writing, through memorials, through vigils, through feasts, through protests, through art, through a myriad of different ways, so that now, and I always will, in the last little bit, have noted that, you know, when Tina Fontaine's body was found, you know, weighted down, thrown in a garbage bag. Everyone in this city and across the country finally felt that issue. Finally, we could look at Tina, and collectively, people said, that's just a little baby. That's just a little girl. But actually, 11 years earlier, there was another little baby, another little girl whose body parts were found. Her name was Felicia Solomon Osborne. She was 16 when she went missing. Her mom got a leg and an arm back, and she was thrown into the Red River. I've worked with that family from the very beginning as well. But there was nothing when those body parts. In fact, the next day when Felicia's body parts were found, the Winnipeg Free Press, the title in their article was prostitute with gang ties found. Meanwhile, she's just a baby, right? So you can see how we've kind of evolved into this moment that everybody, now when Tina was tragically found, I'm sure that everybody in this room felt that, and everybody across Canada felt that, because those seeds were sown. For years and years, those seeds were sown into the public consciousness and into the spirits of Canadians by families and by Indigenous women. And so, I'll leave it at that. It's not a lot of time. But I do want to say that, again, congratulations. And I am so pleased to see that even on the cover, it is a march or a vigil in honor of missing and murdered Indigenous women and girls. And in fact, many of the families that I've worked with for the many years are actually on the cover. And so that's really a testament to where we've come. And I'll say this one story in respect of where we've come. I remember back in 2002, I don't know if people remember this, but back then it was the Liberal government. And at that time, the Liberal government was trying to push forward legislation, the First Nations Governance Act. I don't know if everybody remembers that. They're trying to jam it through and da-da-da. So it just so happened that several chiefs, the Grand Chief and several Indigenous women, I was the Director of Justice at Southern Chiefs back then, we went to Europe. We went on a delegation to go meet. We were at the, UNESCO in Paris. We were at, the French Senate. We met with all of these individuals. We went to the European Union. Back in 2002, nobody knew this issue existed. Nobody. And in fact, I remember back then that people would, oh, there goes Nahani. She's so angry. Like nobody could not even take what we were saying as truth and that here is an issue. And now look, we are on the cusp of a national inquiry, which is, again, years and years of work from families and Indigenous women. So I think that's something for us to all be proud of. And so when we see this, I think it's a great testament to where we are. So I say miigwech.
Okay, thank you, Nahani. Now, obviously, we've run a bit long, but I think if we're all fine, we'd like to take some questions now. They can be in general, or they can be to one of our panelists specifically. So if you have any questions, please raise your hand or let me know, and we can direct them to our panelists or put them out there as a general query for everyone. Any questions? Okay, just to repeat the question for the camera and the microphone. So the question is, why do we think that Winnipeg is sort of a nexus where a confluence of different socially progressive radical activist movements converge? Why Winnipeg? And
that's a much classier question.
And that is a much classier question. Forgive me. I tend to ramble on and Austin like speak when I'm going on 2 hours, actually. So, would anyone like to speak to that? Why Winnipeg? I think Jim actually is possibly the perfect person to answer that.
So it probably goes back to the first decades of the 20th century when into Winnipeg poured tens of thousands of Eastern European immigrants to locate around the rail yards and to work in the factories that had developed along the rail lines, and brought with them from all over Europe left-wing ideas of a bewildering variety. Doug Smith's biography of Joe Zukin has a marvelous first chapter describing the intellectual energy in the North End at that time, and that of course fueled the Winnipeg General Strike, which was a world famous event, and I think put a stamp on Winnipeg. We we had a socialist mayor shortly after 1919. We had a socialist mayor again in the 1930s, John Queen. We elected an NDP government in 1969. I mean, right throughout the 20th century, Winnipeg has, and even today, I would say even today, amongst academics, there's a wildly disproportionate number of academics in Winnipeg who are prepared to be associated with Canadian Dimension or the Canadian Centre for Policy Alternatives and to engage in struggles in the community. And I think all of that has its roots a century ago in those Eastern European immigrants who brought these beautiful and wonderful ideas with them.
On behalf, once again, of the Canadian Dimension Collective and its coordinating committee, and especially on behalf of Cy, I'd like to thank you all for coming to this successful launch of our book. I should have said at the outset that this is the fourth launch that we've actually had. We've launched in Calgary and then in Toronto and Montreal, and we've closed it up here in Winnipeg. So thank you very much, and please do continue reading Canadian Dimension and supporting our magazine. Thank you very much.